There are a lot of Linux distros. One might argue there are too many of them. I would be in that camp. Frankly, I think a lot of distros would better be served as a post-install script on whatever base they're built on. But that doesn't mean I think you shouldn't make a distro. That doesn't mean I think you shouldn't explore what can be done and what use cases you can try to solve. And today, I would like to highlight exactly that. I would like to highlight 10 different distros along with some things which I think should logically be grouped together. So I think it works out to be a bit more than that, but 10 different unique kinds of distros, which hopefully some of them you haven't heard of, others you may have heard of, and I don't know, maybe you'll learn something today. Let's go back long into the past, into a time where there almost wasn't a Linux. December of 1992. This is not the very first Linux distro. A couple of things do predate it, and we'll save those for another time. But it is definitely one of the ones which is very interesting for that time. To be fair, everything's kind of interesting. We're a year into Linux being a thing. There was a distro called Yggdrasil Linux /GNU/X. I am not joking, that is actually what the name is. Otherwise known as LGX, or according to the CD cover, Plug and Play Linux. Its default desktop was FVWM, which a lot of other projects stemmed off of, and the company motto was free software for the rest of us. Keep in mind, this was in 1992, so Linux support, if you think there might be problems now, well, 1992 was a very different time for Linux, a very early time for Linux. Now, the reason why we are talking about this is it's hard to say exactly, as a lot of records from the time have been lost. But it is very, very likely either the first or very close to the first commercially available Linux distribution. You would buy a CD and it contains this distro. And some versions of it have been archived on archive.org, but I've not been able to find the earliest. Now I want to shift gears a bit. We've all heard of Red Star OS, the North Korean Linux distro. Every time people do a video on weird Linux distros, Red Star OS is the one they talk about. But this is not the only state-funded Linux distro out there, and we'd be here all day if we talked about every single one of them, but I would like to talk about two of them that don't really get that much attention. Firstly, we have a distro which I don't fully know how to pronounce. KanemaGNU/Linux, KanemaGNU/Linux, KanemaGNU/Linux. Either way, this is for use within the Venezuelan government, funded by the Venezuelan government. But it is something you can just go and download yourself as well, and it has a bunch of options. GNOME, XFCE, KDE Plasma, LXDE, Mate, and Cinnamon. All of these you can go check out here if you want to, and you can just go and download it if you want to. Another one worth mentioning is Astra Linux. This was originally for use within the Russian government, but has sort of expanded out from there as well. This one's a bit harder to get your hands on because it is actually behind a paywall, but if you find somewhere that you can buy it, you can also just buy it. Or there's probably copies of it online if you want to search around enough. I know people like to talk about Red Star Linux, but having a government-funded Linux distro, this is not unique, especially in places which don't have ready access to Windows. Either Windows is too expensive, the internet connection there is too slow to pirate it, or for various other political reasons, Windows might not be available within the region. Now, let's talk about a distro you've probably heard of that's not a distro if you ask its creator. Universal Blue. If you talk to George Castro, he will say it's not a distro. Fedora is the distro. And UBlue are images built off of the distro, but however you want to frame it, most people tend to call the project a distro, and then things based under it also distros as well. What it is an immutable Linux project, but it's not just one thing. Each of the UBlue projects, if we scroll down to the images here, things like Aurora, Bazite, Bluefin, UCore, all of these are built off of the images that come from UBlue, so it's sort of maybe I don't want to use the pyramid metaphor, but it kind of is a pyramid where you have Ublu at the top and then images based off of the Ublu images, technically Fedora's at the top. So Fedora's at the top, Ublu, and then images based off of that, and then images based off of those images, and then images based off of those images, expanding out further, each of them sort of building off of what the thing, the layer above it does. Let's take the Bazite example. Let's say we have a Steam Deck and we want to be using GNOME. So this is going to build off of the Ublu image. This then has a generic Bazite image, and that has a deck image built off of that, and then a GNOME image built off of that. That makes sense. Maybe not the exact way the stack is laid out, but it's building upon components higher up in the stack. And honestly, I think that is a really cool model for building a distro project because it allows you to go and distribute things at higher levels of the stack as well when they don't want more specialized versions. For example, if they don't want the GNOME version of the image, if they just want the deck version, that is one level higher within the build stack. Now, I talk quite a bit about accessibility, and we want the mainline distros, your Fedora, Ubuntu, OpenSUSE, the things like that, to be accessible. And nowadays, they are doing a pretty good job. But there was a time where accessibility was very sensitive to breakage, and you really didn't want to rely on these distros if you need a screen reader to have your system work. You need Braille, you need a bunch of other things that you cannot have breaking. And because of that, there have been accessibility-centric distros. One example being Slint, not to be confused with the Rust GUI library, also with the same name. This one technically still is in development, depending on how you want to define that. The latest ISO was announced a year ago, or at least updates to making the ISO, so technically still in development. The other one is Vinix. This one very much is dead and has been dead for quite a while now. Both of these distros tried to solve the problem of the mainline distros updating and things breaking. And because of that, they're also quite susceptible to breaking as well, and it was very much advised not to install additional software, not to update things outside of what the distro provides, keep it as is, and then let the distro do the testing, make sure they deal with everything, because it might just break. Everything might just collapse. Whilst these distros are far less important today, they do serve a very important place in the history of Linux and the history of accessible computing. Now, typically a Linux distro is going to have one package manager. You might have different front ends for it, like a GUI and different tools that access the same database, but it's all fundamentally one single package manager. But what if you wanted all of them? What if you wanted Pac-Man and apt and whatever else you could get your hands on? Well, maybe you'd want to look at something called Bedrock Linux. Bedrock is a meta Linux distribution which allows users to mix and match components from other typically incompatible distributions. Bedrock integrates these components into one largely cohesive system. This is also quite popular in the accessibility space because you can take the stable, unmoving Debian tooling and then have updates for things like Orca from something like Arch. In this example, though, we have Debian Stablecore Utils, Arch's Cutting Edge Kernel, Void's Runit, some random stuff from Gentoo, a font from the AUR, games running against Ubuntu libraries, which this shows how old this is. This hasn't been a thing that was important for a very long time, and business software running against CentOS's libraries. This is a distro where 99% of people will get everything they want from using a tool like DistroBox, and DistroBox, frankly, is a better tool for most people. But if you're the kind of person who thinks you might need Bedrock, you're probably the kind of person who needs Bedrock. If you cannot think of a reason why you'd want to do this, it's going to be more of a hassle than it's worth. Just don't do it. This is a distro where you go to it because you have a very specific problem and can't think of a better way to solve it. Now for the next distro, Wolfie, I think the best way to start is just reading the title of this blog post. Introducing Wolfie, the first Linux undistro designed for securing the software supply chain. Basically, it's a distro where its whole purpose for existing is for use within a container, I think is the best way to explain it. We refer to Wolfie as an undistro because it's not a full Linux distribution designed to run on bare metal, but a stripped down one designed for the cloud native era. That just means containers. That's just techie corpo speak for containers. Most notably, we don't include a Linux kernel, instead relying on the environment such as the container runtime to provide this. Now, there are distros that see a lot of container use, things like Alpine Linux. But Alpine Linux, even though it's a weird distro, it's still a regular distro that you can use as, like, a distro. This is not. Its whole function is that containerized environment. Another distro we have is Nitrix. On the surface, it looks like a regular old immutable Linux distro. It's running KDE. It's got a bit of a weird funky theme, but like, that's totally normal for random distros out there. But under the hood, it's made some very odd choices. Firstly, it has OpenRC, which, firstly, you don't really see on that many distros anyway, but I can't think of anything else that's immutable that has OpenRC. Also, it's a distro focused not around Flatpaks, but around app images. And they actually have a software center specifically built around, it's archived now, but specifically built around distributing app images, pulling those app images from a place called the App Image Hub when the site wants to load. It is basically trying to be kind of like the Flatpak of app images. And this format may have fallen out of the limelight, but it's still a very useful and very popular format for application distribution, especially when we're dealing with applications which are Windows applications, but they also happen to have a Linux version. Take, for example, Awakened PoE Trade, which I use to get prices of items in PoE. Now, here's a distro many of you probably have heard of, the Amnesiac Incognito Live System. That probably meant absolutely nothing to a lot of people, but have you heard the name Tails OS? This is a distro that came out of the Tor project, if you couldn't tell by the purple and green accents on the website. And being something from Tor, this is a distro where its entire purpose is privacy and avoiding surveillance. It's basically a distro that is intended to be used as a portable distro. It's not something you're really supposed to use installed on a system. It's something you plug into a machine and then do everything you want to do on that operating system, shut it down, everything is just wiped clean because nothing was saved. And of course, you can do that on other distros as well, like Ubuntu, you can run as a live system, things like that. But this is a distro where it's also going to be making additional changes that make it more convenient and actually usable in this state. It's not supposed to be, oh, you try out the operating system and then you install it. You're supposed to just use it like this and not have to deal with whatever is installed on that computer, especially in cases where you might be in a situation where you can't leave a trace behind. You don't want to have any indication that you are doing anything on that system. Even though in a lot of countries it might be completely fine, in others, you might be doing something potentially illegal. For some, it's a nice way to use Linux on just a random computer. For others, this is a very important privacy tool. Now, are you aware of the Suckless project? Suckless itself is not a distro. This is where projects like DWM, DMenu, ST, and a bunch of others exist. And are you aware of the Suckless philosophy? It's basically how this software is made, how to make software that sucks less. Well, it's not part of the project, but at one point it was. There is actually a Linux distro called Starly, otherwise known as Static Linux. Of course, as you would probably guess, it is a distro that gets rid of systemd, as you can see right here. Don't use systemd, read more about why it sucks. Makes use of muscle-libc and makes a bunch of other changes trying to align with the suckless philosophy. One of those things is, does it say it on the homepage or is another one? No, it's right here. It doesn't have a package manager. The way you update the distro is using Git, because you don't need a package manager, because that makes it suckless. Now, there's one more distro I would like to mention. That is called Q4OS. This unto itself is not really that interesting of a distro. It has a Windows-like KDE theme with text that's way too big on the time. I don't know why it's that big. And a lot of it is all pretty normal. It even has Trinity as an option, which is neat. But the part that I want to mention is this right here. The Windows installer. Yes, this is a Linux distro that you can install from inside of Windows. Now, you might say, how is that possible? Well, it has to basically act like malware, and Windows Defender freaks the hell out when you try to do so, because this is not something that should be doable. At the same time, though, it is really cool, it is really unique, and I've never seen somebody try to do this before. And I think it means it belongs on this list. So there are a lot of other distros we could talk about, and depending on how I feel, maybe I'll do another one of these. If you have any distros you'd like to recommend, please let me know. I'd be happy to either add them onto the list, or they're probably on the list already. So just let me know your thoughts. If you liked the video, go like the video. If you really like the video and you want to become one of these amazing people over here, check out the Patreon, subscribe, Slibarapay, linked in the description down below. That's gonna be it for me, and tell me your weird distro.